Let's go. It's freezing out here. This is the calm before the storm. Just like in the world, the calm before the storm. There's a big storm to hit California. The Pineapple Express is on its way, supposedly. And they're expecting some mega rainfall totals, possible flooding. I had a dream a week ago, and I mentioned it, and it was about this weathercast, and it seemed to be coming from Northern California, and they're giving all these, saying this part's flooded, already flooded, this part's going to flood, but I said that can't possibly be. It must have to do with the world or something, and it has to have some spiritual significance, the dream, but I don't know. Maybe it could be a lot of flooding in Northern California. I mean, it's possible we're going to get a tremendous amount of rain Saturday in the mountain. We're going to get snow first in the mountains, a lot of snow on Saturday, and then Sunday it's going to warm up the rain, and it's going to be rain in the mountains, and then on Tuesday a tremendous amount of snow again. So the mix of the snow, rain, snow could produce a lot of runoff. It should be quite interesting, but right now it's Friday evening. It's the calm before the storm. It's supposed to be about a week of rain coming in, but this weekend's supposed to get really wild and just continuous, just dump buckets. It's the Pineapple Express, a 100-mile wide band of water, the amount of 50 Mississippi rivers, flowing right into sort of centralized California, and we're kind of in the Santa Cruz Mountains. They say it might be up to 12 to 17 inches, depending on where you are. I mean, we're talking about a heavy inundation. That's a lot of water running off, isn't it? So we're just kind of saying, okay. I'm just saying, okay. It parallels the world in that we're at this time right before the inundation. All right, right before the inundation. I had another dream last night. I remembered it just a little while ago when I read something. Somebody posted something about in a blog that someone that I rarely look at it, but I looked at it for some reason. And I said, oh my gosh, that's what I saw in the dream. It's like, uh-oh. I don't want to get into it. It's very negative. It's very negative. But I kind of brushed it off. I said, well, you know, it is what it is, right? We know we're going into the stormy times. The deluge is about to be upon us. And kind of real tired today and sore and just feeling, you know, really beat down because we're in the time of uncertainty. What this age is the age of uncertainty. And it's attempt to deify certainty. It's attempt to use certainty to sanctify reality. I mean, use uncertainty to sanctify reality. It's all this idea of let's see if we can deify and worship uncertainty. Let's see how we feel with massive uncertainty. Well, I've already been there and done that. Okay, so I'm not interested in that. We had that in the 60s. This is going to be even worse than the 60s, way worse. So knowing what I went through in the 60s, I can tell you, you don't want to go through this. You don't want to try and deify certainty, but most are going to. Everyone's gone rogue right now. I feel the world has gone rogue. This is my feeling. And there's nothing I can do exactly really to because the dust is going to be so thick that nobody's going to be quite sure of who, what's what and who's who. You know, who's dharmic and who's non-dharmic? It's the age of uncertainty. So nobody's going to be certain. So if I try to do too much, I'm going to start developing uncertainty about myself. I'm part of dharmic culture. Dharmic culture is the highest culture possible in this world. And I am a citizen of dharmic culture. And as Jesus said, that the lowest in he said the kingdom of heaven, dharmic culture, is higher than the highest in non-dharmic culture, and this is true. But during this time, we're going to try and be, everyone's going to try to be totally uncertain. Like, hey, maybe you're, you know, dharmic culture, or maybe you're not. It will get all messed up in our mind and all confused, and you know, to try to deify uncertainty or confusion. So it's a very tricky time for those in dharmic culture because you don't want to be deceived about it, about yourself. And so I'm not exactly sure what to do really at this point, but I just sort of keep in my stride as best I can. Have a little, have some interesting progress. I don't want to get into it exactly yet on the creative front. I'm starting to learn this little tool I got, this little recorder, and see what happens. I noticed that I got a couple little toys for singing, vocalizing, and when I'm trying to learn how to use them, my creativity drops by like about 90%. But I'm good enough so I can still do it, and it still sounds okay, even with that big drop. And as I start to get used to it, it starts picking back up again. So I don't get overly discouraged. I can understand that people easy to get discouraged when you're just getting into something new, and there's all these bells and whistles. You're not sure how to use it. It's very awkward, and your creativity just, it plummets. It plummets. Same thing in this age of uncertainty. Our creativity is likely to plummet. It's likely to plummet because we're just not sure about anything. Really, can you feel it? We're going right into it now. The swell is coming our direction. The age of uncertainty. The age of uncertainty. That's I dub the age of uncertainty because it's true. It's true. Let me light some incense for this. The age of uncertainty, if we still have any left. So we'll just see what the Dharma Kings will do. It's right now, people just they don't know what to do. They're fixating, pretty much fixating, and so it's hard to just have this creative flow of how I'm used to functioning is just this. It doesn't really matter. I mean, I'm sure of my direction, and I'm just going to have this, playful creative flow. But right now, people are going to say, I'm not sure about that. I'm not sure about that. Right? I'm going to light this incense. So it makes it difficult for me, really difficult. My creativity seems to have dropped quite a bit since last November, actually, when it kind of reached a high point in August, September, October. Before the election, it reached a high point. I was just feeling great and so creative and so free and so confident. But man, I knew it would take a hit, and we're going into the troubles now, and it certainly has. And I'm just not quite able to generate the kind of spontaneous expressions in the world because people now are uncertain. They're not sure. Like, I'm not sure about this. I'm not sure. I just don't quite know what to make of anything, really. Right? I mean, everybody, I hear people say we got to get the fear levels up so we can get anger and then use the anger as energy to protest it. So there's this whole fear-based situation going on. But we don't understand that it's actually our attempt to deify uncertainty, confusion, and say, God, this is the perfection is great, but you created us to sanctify perfection, so we're going to do that through uncertainty. Uncertainty is like the oil, of to sanctify perfection. God did not create us to sanctify perfection. God created us to express perfection, to be perfection, and to be creatively flow with perfection, but not to turn around and say, not to just work on some redundancy that isn't necessary at all. Where's that? Incense is not coming this way. Or did it stop? Maybe it stopped. No, it's still going. Okay. I'm just not getting it. So I've noticed a big drop off, obviously. Obviously. The attention is just not there like it used to be for any of us. And I'm not hitting on all cylinders either, I'd like to, but it just doesn't seem to be happening right at the moment. How is this thing supposed to work? Let me see. It's supposed to, there you go. Everything's a little clumsy. You notice that? I certainly do. Uncertainty. My voice, everything's uncertain. And so, our confidence takes a hit. I can't even put this cap in the right place. You know, I just like fumble at it, kind of. And not that it's easy to do. They don't make it easy, actually. He's got to push down, but yeah. Drinking stuff. I spill stuff. A little spill here, a little spill there. It's little. My mistakes are little, and I catch my mistakes. So that's pretty good. But I'm very aware that we're in this time now where we have the jitters. Till the inauguration. I'm not following the news. I don't know what's happening. People tell me, well, you got to be careful of this. I say, huh? I don't know what you're talking about. I have no idea. I don't know. And it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what's going on in samsaric condition existence. Huh. My throat is tickly and itchy. That's amazing. There's a lot going on right now. Now, the grace of God jumped in today and saved me from trouble. So, here's a great story. I was going to go somewhere and tape, and the end of the day, and I started getting these very odd situations suddenly arising, a cluster of them, and then someone had an accident right in front of me, and I saw it all happen, and I realized, hey, wait a minute, you know, it was like a freak things, just a completely freak accident. It's just bizarre, but I saw it happen, and I said, I better just go home and take it easy and lay low. Really, like, and I spoke to someone else about these, you know, the perfect storm, and how all these little circumstances blend together to create a perfect storm. Someone remarked, that seems to be happening a lot these days, perfect storms. And I said, you know, that's true. And seeing this accident, how it was just such a freak thing that happened. Sort of like a slapstick sort of thing, right? Where someone steps on something and it causes something else to move and it trips somebody up. It's just, you know, it had happened right in front of me. The guy fell right next to me. He got up, but it was like, whoa. You know, it took a bad fall. And I saw, you know, and God was trying to tell me something. So he said, look, Don't go there. The light's not going to be good. If something is not right. So I didn't go, which is very unusual for me. At the last second, I almost went. I said, what the heck? Let me give it a try. And I said, no, I'm going to play it safe. And it turned out to be the right move. I was able to come home, clean the gutters out, and get a sump pump going. That was the circuit had tripped, and get ready for the big storm. So there's a big storm, and I was able to get ready for it instead of storm chasing and doing a video like, oh, look at this, you know, try to do something cool like that. I said, no, it's not necessary. It's not the right time. People are too uncertain. They don't know what to make of what's going on exactly. You know, they can't really, they're not sure what's dharmic anymore. So, you know, I felt, just don't force the issue. Get your own house in order. So that's what I did. And I was able to take the right steps to get the house in order. And this is a great parallel, spiritual parallel. We need to get our own house in order right now. And let's not, you know, don't try to be too fancy. Great advice. Get your own house in order. The storm is coming. The storm is really coming. This is warm tropical moisture pulled up from towards the equator, South America. Coming, I think it's coming from south of Hawaii this time. And it's riding the jet stream. So it's a kind of a perfect storm. They say this only comes along once every 10 years or so. And who knows, it may be a super one. Possible. It's possible. I mean, they're not exactly sure. how much moisture is going to drop and how severe the snow pack could be, but they're talking about, many feet of snow in the Sierras. Some estimate, like one place they were saying, I don't know, so it was so crazy. I couldn't believe it. Like 30 feet. It must be some real high elevation that gets a lot of snow, but they're talking about, yeah, it could be real heavy snowpack, which is great for the California drought, which has been tormenting us for almost 6 years now. We've just been in a state of great nervousness and anxiety about it. So this is really, really going to help a lot, pineapple, if and when it gets here. I hope this isn't just hype like some of the others have been. Yeah, it might be. You can't put anything past what's going on right now. Someone told me today, he says, I believe nothing that I hear and only half of what I see. We're talking about the weather. He says, no, I believe only nothing that I hear and half of what I see. He says that everything is so hype, you just cannot, you can't trust anything these days, which is true. This extremely non-dharmic world we live in right now, non-dharmic culture, electronic culture is a very much a very, very non-dharmic culture. Technology and science, technology, electronics, all of that is extremely non-dharmic. And it's trying to put lipstick on the pig of uncertainty, But as someone said, there's glitches. I mean, there are so many glitches, and it's like we're just beset by glitches everywhere. Back before the electronic age, you didn't have any of that kind of stuff. Maybe like you drive your car, your water pump went out. You go down to the car place, you buy a new water pump. You go in, you get a wrench, take the old one off, put the new one on, and on you go. Like that. You go to church, and then you come home and you sleep soundly. And you want to make a call, you get your phone and you pick up the phone, dial the number, and you get the go right through, and that's it. Dial phone, landline dial phone, that's it. There are no batteries, there's no charging, no nothing. I mean, it was such a better age before electronics came on the scene. That is for sure. The age of science coming to save us, make us happy. No, it's just how many shades of lipstick can we put on the pig? And we just keep shuffling labels, actually. And we're just say, well, I'm not sure about this label. Maybe it's this one. Well, I'm not sure about that. Maybe it's this one. The game of labels is just a game of uncertainty, actually. That's all that it is. It's just a game of uncertainty. Drop all labels, drop all conclusions. Just wow, one label, wow. Not two labels, just one. So there's just one label for everything. Just everything's just wow. Where's the uncertainty? We know what the label is. It's wow. Okay, that's what works actually. That's what actually works. Pretty amazing. It may just have to be patient for a year until the dust settles. My singing hasn't been good ever since I got the cold. I lost all my high notes. I have no stamina with my voice. Before the cold, I was just singing up a storm, and now it's all I can do to sing a little bit. A couple of days ago, I got my voice seemed to bounce back, and I was a very, real very musical voice, but I couldn't sustain it. I was like it was weak, and then got tired easily. This, stupid cold. I don't know. It knocks out all the progress you've made for months and months and months. It diminishes it, so. It's kind of like the world has this, plague that was likely to diminish our confidence and certainty, okay? And that shows up in your voice. I can't quite sing like I was before. It's frustrating. But it's important to not force things, but at the same hand, just, keep it going. Like, I feel lousy today. What happened to all my fitness? Well, it just seems to have just vanished for temporarily. It's the sign of the times that we will lose our confidence, okay? So it's really helpful if you have someone around that hasn't lost their confidence quite as much. Now, I think pretty much everyone is going to lose their confidence to a large extent, but like 90% of $1 million still leaves you with $100,000 if you lose 90%. Whereas if you lose 90% of $100,000, you only have $10,000. So the one that has a lot of confidence to start with, their 10% is still going to seem like a lot compared to the others who may just have their 10% maybe just a little bit. They're like almost like zero for a lot. So, you know, maybe I can still try to help out. I don't know. I feel like, wow, you know, I'm not functioning optimally very much right at this moment, and maybe not for the next year. It's possible, right? It's possible. So it's kind of very humbling to take that hit. But maybe I can help out. I don't know. Or maybe everyone's just saying, man, I just don't know what to make of anything right at this moment. And I just don't know what's confidence and what's not and what's right and what's wrong. It's so confusing. We're into the age of uncertainty and confusion of what's right and what's wrong. It's as if people are just going to just, you know, push it until everyone's just in the state of confusion. That's the trap we're in. It's a confusion trap. So the more you can stay out of the world, just, you know, forget about it. As Jesus said, I loose the world from all I thought it was, and I accept my reality. Okay. I loose the world from all I thought it was, and I accept the reality that I think. Because God created us as reality, so our thoughts we think with God, that's reality. But we tried to think separately from God, and that's what we call the world. So just let go of the world and all the thoughts we think is the world, and accept our true thoughts, our own thoughts. Accept our own thoughts as my reality. Accept my own thoughts as reality. I accept my own thoughts as reality instead of the thoughts of the world. That's a practice that Jesus gives. But we may have trouble with practicing. It's possible. This is what I'm feeling as a possibility. I just don't feel that. I feel people. Everyone's having trouble. Everyone's having trouble right now, and it's still there with me. But it's just sort of like feeling like, wow. Hard to get any momentum going. But I'll do my best for sure. But I don't know what's going to happen the way things are going right now. You know, how bad the decline will be. Could be some really shocking news coming up if my dreams were accurate. But just, you know, take it in stride and don't just let go of the world. Don't worry about it. It's not dharmic. You know, if you want to be part of dharmic culture, you have to accept you're already there. You're already there. And dharmic culture doesn't worry about the world. And the ups and downs and what it does, all that, it's neither here nor there. It's just uncertainty. And Dharma culture is all about certainty. Okay, it's an adamant tone of certainty. Not conciliatory, you know, and say, well, maybe there is some uncertainty about reality. There's no uncertainty about reality. None. There's no uncertainty about reality. So, Dharmic culture, a citizen of Dharmic culture, which I am, is very certain. They don't entertain doubts, really, at all. And of course, right now, this we're in this this age of doubt, uncertainty, confusion. Doubt, uncertainty, confusion. So it's an attempt to collapse Dharmic culture, is what it really is. Let me see if this incense went out. It might have gone out. See, isn't that interesting? Even the incense can't stay lit right now. And I don't know if I can relight it because this lighter seems to have gone out. Amazing. Usually the incense does not go out like this. And it doesn't look like I can relight it. I got some flame there. Let's see if I can get it lit. Wow, it doesn't want to even light. That's amazing. Okay, I got it lit there. Whoops. Ouch. The incense stick was right by the cable to the video, and it burnt it. Wow, I couldn't see that because it was black. It's pitch dark, and I couldn't even see. It's a black cable, and it was so. I was. Let me see if it's damaged. Fortunately, it's not. But that's just another example of clumsiness. Wow, super clumsy. I'm really clumsy now, and just not picking up on stuff. Let's see if the microphone got hurt. That's okay. It's I'm just. Because I'm moving stuff around. I'm bringing in some other stuff and it's in the way. I couldn't see clearly here. It's crowded. Nothing seems quite right, as a matter of fact, right now. Nothing seems quite right. It's all a little bit off. It's complex. It's getting confusing. The world, the way things are going right now. So, fortunately, I caught the mistake again. I said, hey, wait a minute, and stopped it. Knocked the incense stick off somewhere, went somewhere, who knows where. Better not start a fire. I don't know where it is. Wow, it's amazing. Everything is a little clumsy. Little accidents are happening. Just like I saw today, that accident happening. Just a really bizarre thing. It's all that way right now. So it's a good time to just kind of lay low. Just lay low. Don't ask too much of yourself right now. And just laugh. I've been bursting out in laughter. I suddenly make a breakthrough and it's just laughter. And then I'll go back into this kind of nervous state, uncertain state, and then another breakthrough, just laughter. That's what's happening. Listening to this song All Summer Long by the Beach Boys, All Summer Long. See, I've been with you. I've been. Can't remember the lyrics. See, that's how befuddled I am. And but then it says, "Won't be long till summertime is through." And it says, "But not for us now. But not for us now." Every now and then we hear a song. Won't be long till we've been having fun all summer long. So we've been. It goes. Everything is ra so our cage is rattled right now, no question. But the idea is. Summer's ending for everybody. Okay, this is the theme of the song. We had so much fun in the summer, but it won't be long till summertime is through. But then they sneak in this ver this sort of chorus says, "But not for us. But not for us. But not for us." That's why I love that song. It sets this theme of how cool summer is. T-shirts, cutoffs, and a pair of thongs. We've been having fun all summer long, sitting outside. Sitting in our car outside your house. Remember when you spilled Coke all over your blouse? Coca-Cola, that is. T-shirts, cutoffs, and a pair of thongs. We've been having all fun all summer long. So we can continue to have fun, but we have to get in that vibe somehow. It's summer's through for the world, okay, but we're not of the world. Dharma culture is really not of the world. So summer's not really over for us. It's an endless summer. My favorite movie when I was young was, I think it was Bruce Severson or something, The Endless Summer. I'm not sure who made that surf film, The Endless Summer. It was so cool. And the surfers just followed summer around the globe. And you know, went to the southern hemisphere when it was winter in the northern hemisphere, and they just stayed. It was all wherever they were, it was summertime, and they were surfing these great waves. And that was the movie back then. It was very popular. So, the Endless Summer, and then the song All Summer Long by the Beach Boys. And interestingly enough, I met this the man, a musician, and we had a really good talk. You know, and he told me that he was in the building recording a song with his dad when he was a teenager, and his dad was a musician that played was in the recording studio, one of the studios there in Los Angeles, and Brian Wilson walked by, and he said, "Hey kid, how you talking?" Sort of asked him, "Hey, how you doing? And what are you doing?" "So I'm just hanging out, waiting for my dad. He's playing with this group in here." And he said, "Oh, that's cool. That's great." He said, "Hey, why don't you come inside here? You know, don't have to stand out in the hall. Come on inside and into our session. Just hang out inside." And so he went in. And inside was the Beach Boys and I believe the Wrecking Crew, all the studio musicians. And he got to listen to the recording session of All Summer Long as the Beach Boys recorded. And he said how Brian Wilson was just so absolutely amazing how he did it. And now, tonight, I was looking for that song All Summer Long. And there's this Past Masters, or Recording Masters, video that has the actual videotape, audio tape of the whole session. It was like 30-minute session, basically. Well, that wasn't the whole session, but a 30-minute session where they did all these takes. And you can hear Brian Wilson talking and orchestrating and how they try to get the song together. It's just absolutely amazing. The background, the instruments, just the instrumentation is so complex and so subtly. The harmonies are so amazing, the progressions he has, and he's just genius. And then of course the singing and how he put that song together, you're talking about just an absolute masterpiece. Just, you know, how do you get that sound? Well, you can kind of hear in the recording session how they did it. And so my buddy that I talk with, he was there as a teenager, and he witnessed that, the recording session of that song. That is so amazing. And that I would meet somebody that was actually in that recording session of the song All Summer Long. And that just is, you talk about synchronicity. And that's always been one of my favorite songs. And it's perfectly apropos for right now. So how about that, the grace of God, you know, how that works? So that was at the Dharma King conference that I went to. And he was singing there. That was just so extraordinary. So, won't be long till summertime is through, but not for us. But not for us now. Yeah. Every now and then we hear our song. We've been having fun all summer long. Every now and then we hear our song. We've been having fun all summer long. So during this time where maybe it is sort of a winter time of the world, the winter time of uncertainty, maybe we can every now and then hear our song. And for us, summer won't end. Now, you know, can that happen? It's possible. It's possible, actually. If the Dharma Kings want it, it's possible. So, it's really important, again, to see someone in the world that's still just flying high. It's like summer hasn't ended for them. You know, the summer of certainty hasn't ended in the winter of uncertainty and doubt and confusion in this terrible dark period we're entering. That just to stay in touch with someone who's just still totally in summer mode. It's like, the song of summer is still playing. The song of summer is still playing. So I'd love to do this for everyone in the world. The song of summer is still playing somewhere. And I'll give it a try. I'll give it a try. See how it goes. See how it goes. But I don't know if anybody will understand what's going on. Really, I can try it here on YouTube and just keep, you know, putting videos out and explaining a little bit. And maybe there will be a groundswell of interest as we go along. I don't, or maybe people are so confused, they just say, I just can't get with anything right now. Yeah, a friend of mine told me he's just going to take drugs and laugh at it, the whole thing. I mean, pretty much just ha, 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 you know, drug laugh sort of thing. I mean, just a lot of people are just going to take drugs. That's what they're going to do. I say sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You know, a lot of people are going to do that. But here, we're going to keep the endless summer going. The song of summer will continue to be sung. The song of certainty, the certain song of summer will continue to be sung. The certain song of summer will be, continue to be sung. And hopefully every now and then you could say, ah, there's my song. It's still being sung somewhere in the world. And this will, like, you know, kind of keep like a little fire going. It's kind of like you're out in the snow, you're freezing, but there's a, you're able to get a little fire going. And to keep you alive, that actually happened to me once. Saved my life. I was able to get a little, some little heat going, something like that, yeah. Someone was able to, someone was so skillful with fire, they were able to get some, a little fire going, and it saved my life. So maybe I can get a little fire going, and it could help, it can help everyone. And, you know, it's just, you have to share it with other people, and maybe that'll be part of your helping keep the fire going with you, even though people won't listen. Just try. I don't know how it'll work, but it's really important. It's really important for someone to genuinely have that certainty going, sing the certain song, the summer song of certainty. Sing that summer song of certainty during these times that we're going into. It's extremely important. And the more the better. But the problem is that people won't really have a hard time. They'll have a hard time understanding what's dharmic and what's not dharmic. And just say, I'm not sure. You know, vacillating this. So I know that I'm dharmic. The world freed me, let me go. They said, you belong to the king. This king, great king's culture. You don't belong to us. We understand that is true. So, you know, you're free to go. You don't really belong to the world, and that's true. I have certainty, and have been accepted into dharmic society, dharmic culture. Having experienced, you know, great many of the important recognitions of certainty and. Right, no, I understand right now it's a time of uncertainty, so it's pretty difficult to dial that in. I'll do what I can. So that's a great idea. That's a very helpful idea right now, in a time right now of really, we're really, especially in California, it's interesting, things tend to happen here first. We have this, you know, massive storm coming in. It's just going to douse everything, just going to severely douse everything. And it's kind of like in the world, there's a great river of uncertainty ready to come in and just douse our spiritual fire, the spiritual fire of certainty. The spiritual fire is really certainty. I'm certain that all of truth is true. There's no such thing as any truth that's not true. Okay, I'm certain of all that. And the idea that there's some truth that might not be true is a lie. That is the lie. It's not that a lie says all of truth is untrue. No, the lie is to say that a little bit of truth is untrue. That's the big lie. Because all of truth is true. So the big lie is to say even a little tiny bit of truth is not true. That's a total lie. 100% lie. Huge lie. So my hope, you know, my hopes for going forward this year is a whole bunch of people just are singing the song of certainty. But I'm not seeing that exactly. I'm not really seeing that. We're struggling. There's no question they're struggling. So I'll do the best I can. and see what happens. See what happens. I don't know, how it's going to play out, really. Maybe, right? Maybe some can join in. Maybe we can, some can join in. Possible, huh? But really, it has to be the song of certainty, the summer song of certainty. I was born in summer, Leo. Middle of August, kind of. Just past the middle of August. So I've always had this trait of summer certainty. This feeling like, the good times will never end. They'll never end. It's only good times and they'll never end. And I don't care what the world does, it's not going to end my good times at all. My good no times, the no time. I got no time for time. I have no time for bad times. There's only good times and no time for bad times. There's no time for time, actually. So I have this. Leos are great at this summer song, singing the summer song. While others are, kind of shaking and cowering in fear. The lion is just relaxed and saying, "No, I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid of anything. Everything's great. Everything is perfect summer for me. It's just, wow. It's just wonderful." But of course, people say, "Are you sure? Are you sure?" And so you get too much of that. You need to isolate yourself from that. Are you sure? Because people's minds right now are very full of uncertainty. They really are. And for me, yes, I'm sure, but you can't really convey that so easily at this time. But, hey, the Dharma Kings, we don't know what they'll do. The indications are pretty amazing, some pretty amazing stuff, actually. One of our intensive members put up a video of a Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, and I used to have that video, and I can't find it anywhere. I gave all my stuff away to one of her ashram centers, and I can't find the video. I've never been able to find it since. And then here is this clip from that video of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, the Queen of Wow, arriving at a train station, getting all these flowers put on her. That's one of my favorite clip scenes of her. Maybe the number one scene of her ever is that. That is so fantastic. It's this massive crowd at a train station, and she pulls in and gets off the train, and people are just draping her with flowers, and they're just beside themselves with joy. Everybody. I mean, it's the best video clip I've ever seen, I think, in the history of the world, because you never see anything like that. You've never seen anything like it, because these people are just, I mean, they can't talk. They don't know what to say, what to do. They're just beaming. Everyone is just beaming. And she's just in this, just radiant, blissful condition of just love and bliss and just looking at everybody like just ador like she just adores them, so just adores everybody. The world's just totally adorable. And everyone to her is just totally adorable. And the people are just, their hearts are just melted, and here, and she gets off the train. They've been waiting, waiting, waiting for her, and she arrives. She arrives, and it's just such a profound situation. And then she takes the flowers off, and she puts them on other people like this, and they're just melted. Everybody's just melted. It's like summer has just, the song of the certain song of summer has suddenly just arrived, and everyone is just like they for the world has vanished. Obviously, they weren't the world. It's gone for them. It vanished. All their troubles, you could see. They completely forgot about their miseries, their troubles, everything. You could tell. There's no doubt about it. All their aches and pains, the heartaches they've had, the regrets. During that time when she arrived at that train station, they didn't have any of that. It was gone. So, this is a very auspicious video posting. very auspicious and synchronous. So this has to mean something. She's been on my mind. I was at yesterday, powerfully, 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 and so I know she's going to do something. Ah, and another post. Yeah, I mean, just wow, wow. I gotta get to work here. This is amazing. The Queen of Wow, you can't. Everything's just wow. When she steps off that train, your whole world just transforms. There's no more world. There's just wow. That's it. So we practice just wow. It's just wow, because that's a reality. When she steps off a train, it's just wow, and there's nothing else exists. And you might think, oh, you know, exaggerating. No, I'm not exaggerating. That's why it's so extraordinary. You think, how can I, this must be exaggeration, but no, it's true. And you say, oh my gosh, it's like our expectations get melted. I still, every time I see the Queen of Wow, I just can't, you know, I just, it's beyond belief. Still, nonstop familiarity. It's still just the same disbelief. You know, it's absolutely cannot believe that this could have happened here. You know, it's just, you could never even imagine it, such a thing. Such a situation. She was just totally beyond belief. Totally beyond belief. There's no way you can believe it. That's okay. We're beyond belief, too. She's actually our true self. Sri Sri Nandamayama was just a representation, an appearance, a representation. Perceptual representation of our true self. This is a fact. That's why the first time I saw her, I said, oh my gosh, this is what I really am. And what I really am has somehow appeared here. How is that possible? It seems impossible. Because we're not actualizing any of it, really, are we? And yet here it is, being actualized like this, you know, like 100% kind of. I mean, you could say it's toned down a little bit there, right? And she said, yeah, it's not the great bliss. If I go in the great bliss, I would become non-functional here. So it's toned down a bit, but still, you know, it's just like, holy cow, how is that possible? And yet it happened. It is possible. Which means our confusion is much ado about nothing. Our uncertainty is nothing at all. It's just a farcical whim on our part. You know, it doesn't touch reality at all. None of that stuff touched her. It didn't touch her at all. Our uncertainty had no effect on her at all. How can you do that, you know? But she did it. The one self did it. The one self did it. Our true self, our true self did it, came here and pulled into a railroad station and got off the train. And there we were, just uh, And the thing about her, she had no mercy. She never let up. It's like you say, God, that's too much for me. Can you just let up? No. But she would leave. She said, okay, see you later. And it's like, oh, wait, don't go, but I've had too much. I don't know. Can you not tone it down? No, she wouldn't tone it down, really. That's our, our real self is like that. It's 360 degree. It's full on 360 degree right now. And it never stops being that way. So there's two things going on right now I'm aware of. There's this we're being swept into the age of uncertainty right now. Like a wave at Nazaré in Portugal. I saw this video today of the waves and people getting swept in to shore by the rocks and everything and how it works. And I was like, oh, wow, interesting. But they did find a beach in there. But they it's like these huge waves are like sweeping us and battering us right now. There was an interview with a guy that really got hammered, and his friend, it showed his friend took this hideous wipeout, and he said he saved his friend's life, and he said his friend was non-functional. He couldn't think, he couldn't hear, he just couldn't. He was alive, but he was hit so hard that by the wave that he was so confused, and this man in a jet ski was able to grab him. Actually, he lost his jet ski. A wave came in and smashed his jet ski, took it away from him. And he was in the water, and he was able to hold his friend and get him into safety because his friend was just he was alive, but he was couldn't function. The wave hit him so hard. And I just watched that video. I should post that too to Facebook. Wow. I'm posting stuff, but no, it's only a couple of people are viewing and commenting or liking or one or two. That's it. So it's such so slim. It's hard to stay motivated really, because this stuff is really important. Actually, we have to understand this video I saw is showing us what's going to happen, and this man is in a restaurant narrating what had happened to him a couple of days earlier. Whereas he took a hideous wipeout, was coughing up blood, and then he switched over to the jet ski, and his friend wanted to try surfing, so his friend went out, and his friend took this mother of all terrible wipeouts and was just about killed. He saved him, saved the life, lost the jet ski, it got pushed into the cliff and the rocks. He was able to rescue the jet ski, get it started again, and just escape the waves, and so it all ended well. But it was like a really, really hairy situation, really intense, on the edge sort of situation. Well, we're in that situation right now. And then so we have that situation. We're getting massive waves are now coming in, crushing us, and we're wiping out. And then we have Sri Sriananda, my mother, the Queen of Wow, who's given me this heads up, very potent heads up. Very potent heads up. She's completely beyond belief. Ourself is completely beyond belief, actually. But we can at least believe in wow, right? Just believe wow. I believe in wow. I believe in wow. I've been having, I've been wowing everything all summer long. And looks like summertime is through. No, it looks like wow time is through. No, not for us. Wow time is not through. It will continue. So something is going to bring this, spirit of wow into the world somehow, or help us with it. I don't know what she's going to do. She's going to do something for sure. All the Dharma Kings will, but the Queen of Wow is the Queen of Wow. Okay, and we have had direct experience with her through her videos and pictures here to such an extent, and we know people that have known her, And I mean, there's a friend of mine on Facebook, spent a lot of time with her, actually, when she was young, and was with her a lot. And you know, there are people on Facebook that were with her in India. She is the Queen of WoW is the Queen of WoW. There's really nothing else to say about it. And she sees us the way she sees us. She's just adores us. You know, you just see the absolute love and adoration she has for us. And that's what is just so absolutely. We think, are you kidding me? Look, I'm an absolute mess. And no, that's the fake mind that's just promoting this mess to try to sanctify what we already are. But we don't need that fake mind to sanctify what we already are. And so she reinforces the fact that we're perfect right now. She sees us as this awesome perfection, this glorious, you know, perfection that we are. And so, and she just, you know, just absolutely loves it, just adores us. And that's really tough for us to take, right? We think, oh, we're not worthy. Well, not be that the imaginary mind that we've just imagining to promote uncertainty. Uncertainty is just our imagination. There's no uncertainty as a fact at all. But to promote it, to play this little game, we think we're greater than God, that we're somehow sanctifying God. That mind is certainly being imagined as full of uncertainty. But she doesn't, she knows that's not our real mind at all. So she just completely overlooks that. Completely overlooks it. As Jesus tells us to do, that we can do that also, but she does it. And that's just so amazing to come across one who completely overlooks it, 100% just overlooks it like it never was. It never was ourself. And just to come into contact with that, I can tell you that there's no experience like that. There's nothing that can compare experientially like that. And she looks at the whole world that way too. Everything is just absolutely 100% perfectly adorable to her. Just through and through. And it's no fake. I mean, it's the real thing, the real deal. It's there. And so what that can do for us is just immeasurable, isn't it? So again, guaranteed she's going to do something. I'm just not sure exactly how it'll play out. So we must not give up hope. We must continue this certainty, the wow certainty. I'm certain just everything is wow, completely wowish. I know that is true, and I'm not going to draw any other conclusions at all. See, this takes us out of the confusion and uncertainty because we're in certainty, and we refuse to draw any other conclusions. Well, that gets us real close to certainty, isn't it? It does. It keeps us close to certainty. And we say, I'm just wow and no other conclusion. That's the ticket. It's the ticket. And, you know, we'll see. We'll see. Maybe some can get with this. I'm not really getting much feedback at all. On this, and I'm certain that this is the ticket. So I'll just keep preaching it. Okay. Don't draw any conclusions except wow. It's the only just one conclusion, and no, none other. Just everything is wow. You're wow. The world is wow. The universe is wow. Everyone is wow. Everything is wow. That is all that it is. I'm certain of this. I'm drawing no other conclusions whatsoever. And wow is just one step below adorable. Perfect, perfect, perfectly adorable. It's just one step below. And so we have to be accept this. Okay, so we're still in practice mode. The Queen of WoW is not in practice mode. Okay. She's never been in practice mode, really. the Leela of Sadhana in Bhajapur was just a play of sadhana that she was having fun playing it. It wasn't really uncertainty at all. She said always there was a certainty there, always. So we are Dharma practicers, okay? That's what we do. That's our job, okay? Let the Dharma Kings do their job. Let us do our job, and don't try and, you know, do more than we can do at this point. So it's just healed perception. Wow. No, just one conclusion. Wow, that's called healed perception. Really, we can get to healed perception. Beyond healed perception, you drop perception altogether, basically. But that's not our goal. First, our goal is to stabilize in no other conclusions, but wow, just one conclusion. And we have to stabilize and abide in that one conclusion, just wow, everything is wow. And then once we're really, really just able to just stay in that and abide in that, and it's just it's like as natural as breathing to us, or more so, then Jesus said God takes the final step for us. When God knows we're ready, even we could even go beyond that ultimately, but we're not at all. That's God's deal, not ours. Our deal is to take healed perception as far as we can and abide in just the wow, the one conclusion. Wow, that's it. And already there. I'm already there. It's already a done deal. That's how Dharma practices. That's how Dharma culture practices. Already a done deal. No doubt about it. No uncertainty about it. It's done. So you don't want to go down into the fear, do you? You don't want to go down into the uncertainty, which is fear. You want to say, no, it's still summer on the inside. I know it's still summer on the inside. I know I'm still wow. I know everything is still wowish. All right? I know it. So all this superficial uncertainty, I don't really want to pay any attention to that. I'd rather pay attention to the certain song of summer being sung. Just be like that. Just be like that. Just be like that. Okay. I don't want to stay out too late here. I got my watch fixed. It's amazing stuff is happening. It's like time. This watch actually stopped January 1st. Went blank. No time. And other stuff is happening that I'm like, wow. The synchronicity is still with us, you know? Even though everybody seems to be very uncertain now, guess what? The synchronicity is still happening. It's amazing synchronicity. Now, my friend that fell today, ultimately, I ended up brushing off his back. In other words, I have your back. And he said, thank you, brother. You know, he's just like, well, yeah. I was with him. I say, hey, you know, you're fine. You're fine. Everything's great. But let me brush your back off, you know, because he couldn't reach that part, you know, to brush his back off. So maybe, you know, so we're not able to, we take a tumble and we get up, but we still feel like if someone would just, you know, brush my back off and pat me on the, you know, just let me know that I'm still fine, I'm still wowish, that'll help me a lot. So I'll see what I can do, you know, and see how the Queen of Wow is going to help out to just say, you know what, you're still totally wowish. You know, doesn't matter, you took a nasty fall. It was a trap that was set up to trip you up like that. I saw the whole thing. I know exactly what happened. And that's what happened. I saw that an accident happen right in front of me. I saw, oh my gosh, that I see his foot caught there, and I see him tumbling. It was like slow motion, but it was like I was the perfect place to see it perfectly. Amazing. There's another synchronicity. Everything is synchronicity right now, it seems like, right? It really is, actually. I got my pump going that the Christmas lights had short-circuited it, a sump pump. And we need that sump pump. And just before it got dark, I took a flashlight. It was getting real dark. I went out there. I was able to reset the circuit. And suddenly the pump started working. It pumped a whole lot of water out that had backed up, actually. And so now that sump pump is ready to go and keep the water flowing and not back up. So that's another synchronicity. It's like, maybe I'm ready to keep flowing. I'm ready to keep, I won't get all jammed up. It's possible. It's very possible. I figured out how to do overdubbing on this little handheld digital recorder I have now. I got these attachments. I can now do line in and record through two bottom jacks. So I can record a song, and at the same time I can do four channel recording. I can record in stereo by singing, and then I can then overdub that to add another stereo overdub to it, and then overdub that, and I can just go endlessly overdubbing. And I figured out how to do it. So that's pretty cool, actually. That's really cool. And the microphone sounds great. I mean, my voice sounds great. I haven't figured out how to adjust the tone on it yet. I don't know if there's a tone adjustment or not. I didn't see that yet. There's too many bells and whistles on everything these days. I just wish things were a lot simpler. But the mics with a little bit of reverb, you know, my voice when I'm singing right, I could see, the potential, you know, it's certainly it's all there. It's a really good sound. It's got a really good sound. I record in WAV format, 16-bit WAV format. It sounds really good. So I say, wow, that's cool. That's cool. Once you get all that, you know, how to do it, technical stuff ironed out a little bit, then you can stop worrying about it and actually start sounding musical. There's a difference between singing and sounding musical. And I have that extra gear when I'm feeling it. I can sound musical, and I can hear the difference. It's obvious. It's like I just shift gears into like Ferrari mode, and suddenly I just start putting all sorts of accents on everything, and it's just like, wow, okay, that's musical. That sounds really musical. Sounds, instead of just singing it, anyone can sing, but it takes an extra gear to sing it in a really in a musical way. And then when you hear that, it says, ah, that's music to my ears. That's music, actually. It's not just singing, it's music. There's a difference. Right now, there's a lack of music in the world, actually. We're not musical anymore. Really, we're not. I was very musical coming into this world, from my history, previous lives. I'm very musical. Very soulful, very musical and soulful. But the world is not soulful or musical anymore. It's just noise. It's just singing and recording and songs and noise and stuff. But it's not music. It's not musical. It really isn't. It's technical. It's technical. Everything is technical. It's not musical anymore. I grew up in the soulful era, you know, the soulful 60s. I mean, wow. It's very soulful. You kidding me? Motown and rhythm and blues and just, you know, there was so much all across the board. People sang with soul. And man, it's just where has that gone, really? You know, it's not really around the same way at all, and because we're way too technical of a society right now. We've lost our soulfulness, actually. We've lost our summer. We're in the winter of technicality, you know, of tech. We're in the high tech winter right now, the winter of discontent. There's some disco music in this store I was in yes a couple days ago. Man, I was just dancing to it, just grooving to it. It was, man, I mean, some of the stuff in the disco music, actually looking back, it was cool. We didn't like it at the time because we were still in the soulful 60s. You know, what is this stuff? You're supposed to dance to it, you know. We some of the soulful stuff we didn't, you know, dance to. It was just like, oh, we just kind of dig the soul, the feel of souls there. But disco's all about dancing, and so this music was so danceable, and I was like just dancing through the aisles. I was dancing through the aisles of a grocery store, really just moving to it. It was great. It was so great. And then last night I was in the kitchen And I just started like dancing, moving a little bit. And suddenly I understood dancing. I've never understood it. Why? Because I'm so skinny now. I'm thinner, and I'm kind of wiry, my strength and everything. And I suddenly realized why teenagers can dance so good. And why women can dance so good is because the hips. You got to throw the hips. It's the difference between the waist and the hips. You got to make this differentiation between the waist and the hips. You got to be a hipster. That's why they call those all the people '60s, the hipsters, '50s, '60s. The way they danced, you know, was this way of moving the hips, throwing the hips, and then everything revolves around that dichotomy of the waist and the hips. And if you don't, if you have tried to make it just one, you know, the waist and the hips are all just one thing, then you're kind of shuffling your feet. But if you start throwing the hips around and moving like that, oh man, you start like a palm tree. I mean, you really can dance. So I suddenly I got it. I got dancing. I guess I understand. Oh my gosh, this is what it is. You really have to let yourself go. You got to throw the hips. If you can't do that, you can't really dance. You're not really dancing. You're moving, but not dancing. Just like people sing, but it's not music. People dance, but it's not dancing. It's technique. It's technique. Everything right now is just technique. It's technical. It's not really dancing, and it's not really music. What's going on in the world right now? You see this stuff, all these choreographed stuff. It's all technique. But, you know, back in the day with some people were dancing, I remember in the 60s, you look, it's just like, oh my gosh, what a groove, how soulful they are. You know, the dancing is so soulful. Everybody wasn't limited to just certain groups. No, it wasn't. And the hippies, of course, learned how to throw their hips. They learned how to groove. You know, they caught that groove. And so I'm sort of catching that groove right now, actually, of actually being musical and dancing, being a hippie, a musical hippie dancer, but in a dharmic way, in a dharmic way. Not trying to be redundant and trying to throw some redundancy on the Dharma. Okay, which is some a lot of the hippies did tried that, you know, they tried too hard, like they were here to sanctify the world. No, Nanda Mayamma didn't come to sanctify the world. She just came to assure us the world is already perfectly sanctified. Every single one of us is. And she just adores it. She just absolutely adores us. Just let her do that. You know, that this is what we have to do. We just let her adore us. You know, within Christianity, we say, "Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Christ the Lord. Come, all you faithful." But it's the opposite way. You know, they have it backwards. It's really Jesus comes to adore us. Okay, the self, Christ, the true self, comes to reassure us that, you know, we're totally loved. The one self. Still totally loves itself. Totally loves itself. Everything about itself. Absolutely everything about itself. It loves. And everything is the one self. There's only the one self. There's only the one eternal life. And the one eternal life just absolutely adores itself. And these Dharma kings come in the world to assure us of that. Ram Maharshi. If he's looking at you, he just loves you. You look at his eyes and he's not just like blissing out in some, you know, some trip. No, he's just shining the love that he has for you. He's just shining the love. Just let him shine the love. Let them shine the love light on you. There's a sign. There's love light. Edgar Winter Band. I gotta find that song. Live at the Apollo Theater in Harlem. Come on, shine your love light. You gotta shine it on me. It's a very lively song. Maybe a little too lively, but come on, let your love light shine on me. Just let it shine, shine. Let it shine, shine, shine. Shine on me. Maybe I'll sing that one. My voice bounces back. So just let the Dharma King's love light shine on us. Let it shine on us. We don't have to let our light shine on them. Let their light shine on us. Just accept it. Because that's the real thing. They're letting you know. They're just reassuring you. Accept the reassurance. Just say, wow. Don't try to overdo it. You know, in the 60s, people tried to overdo it. For us, it's enough. Just wow. Just let the wow. Just full stop in the wow. And it'll get into us. That's how we get familiar with it. So I was practicing the full stop in the wow last week, I think. And I was just really just doing so great. And I looked at myself in the mirror and I saw myself. I said, oh my gosh. I look like golden. I said, wow. Oh my gosh, you just look just beautiful golden look. I said, oh my gosh. So the self is coming through, you know, allowing, just wowing the self. We get used to it and we begin to recognize what we really are. We begin to see ourselves as what we really are. But it has to come through just refusing to draw any conclusions except wow. As soon as we start drawing other conclusions, we have uncertainty of labels. And it starts creeping into us like a cancer, like a spiritual cancer. Okay, so here we go with the raid. It's starting to start right now. Pitter patter, pitter patter. Listen to this rhythm of the falling rain, telling me what a fool I've been. There's another one. I can vocalize that. I can. How can I do this? Oh, I can actually do it off of YouTube. I could take any song off. Wow. I could take any song off of YouTube, off the stereo. No, I can't. I don't have the right jacks yet. Well, we'll see what I can do. I'll have to work on that. I need some splitter from. No, that's headphones, a stereo jack. I can do it, and go into the recorder, and over and sing along with it and record that. Mix my own vocals in with any song on YouTube, actually. Holy cow. But then, I mean, I could post it, and it'll be banned in Germany. But almost all artists allow their songs to be posted on YouTube, but it then becomes monetized, and advertisements on it, and monetized for them in some way. And they share the royalties with that. Whereas on other stuff like SoundCloud, you're not supposed to do that. Facebook, you're not supposed to do that. But somehow YouTube has this agreement that the artists allow it. So theoretically, I could do that. I don't know, you know, how kosher that is exactly. But I could, like, karaoke along with it. I could. Any song. There's so many great songs, actually. So many musical songs that there was some musicality to it. So just so you know, somebody is still just absolutely just wow in summertime. Just absolutely wowed by this awesome summer that's still going on. The endless summer. I'm just wowed by the endless summer. And then you can catch that vibe, just like I caught that vibe off the movie Endless Summer. I bet you it's on YouTube, Endless Summer. I could watch that. I caught this vibe, and my whole thing growing up was like, for me, summer's never going to end. It's never going to end. I was so determined. So I just hate, you know, when the winter came, I just hate it. I said, no. I'm never going to seed summer to winter. I'm never going to seed it. And I go throughout the whole year wearing just sandals, t-shirt, and shorts, summer attire, the whole year round, even though it's winter time. I just said, no, for me, it's still summer. It is still summer. It's always summer for me. So I always try to keep summer going in my mind. And as the world going towards this horrible, winter of uncertainty. I got really bummed out thinking maybe I might lose summer. I might lose it. And then, of course, the Dharma Kings came to my rescue and said, no, 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 we won't let you lose summer, the summer of certainty, the endless summer of certainty. We won't let you lose it. We'll help you keep it. So it's still with me. It's still with me. And I'm driving along. It's, real cold this morning. It's real cold here. And I put on the Beach Boys, and I'm driving, and I'm just singing all summer long. And I was just singing the heck out of it. Not as good as I can, because my voice isn't good right now. But still, I was just grooving. Absolutely just, for me, it's 1960, it's the summer of 1969. And it's just, it's Woodstock. We're just saying, hey, it's never going to end, And then, of course, all the bad stuff started in the second half of, funny, right after my birthday, my 13th birthday, all the bad stuff started happening in 69. And the summer was over. The summer of love that we've been writing in the 60s came to an end, at least on the surface. At least on the surface. But in me, I said, no, 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 no. It's not ever going to end. It's not ever going to end. And it hasn't. It hasn't ended. It's still with me. So anything that has a summer vibe, like surfing. I'm trying to, watch surf videos. It just gives you this, hey, the summer vibe. Although they keep throwing too many girls in bikinis in there. And I'm not into bodies at all anymore. I'm not. Bodies are, I see them as just rotting corpses. They have nothing to do with what I am. I'm not, they're creatures. I'm not attracted to creatures anymore. I really am not. Animals are creatures. We had this option to get these two cats, these gorgeous cats, and I said, no, 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 no. It's not time for creatureness. People are trying to get through the winter of uncertainty with hanging on to a dog. Excuse me. Excuse me. I tried that. It doesn't work. That's not the dharmic way to do it. Creatures, clinging to creatures is not the dharmic way to do it. Turning your attention to the Dharma Kings is the way to do it. Okay? Turning your attention to the Dharma Kings is the way to get to it because, they overlook the creatureness. That's all make-belief. To them, we're not creatures at all. Sri Sri Anandamayi said when someone asked her, how do you see us? And she says, I don't see you as bodies at all. I see you as this golden light. That's how I see you. I don't see your body. So there's no creature there. There's no creature there. So I said, no, it's not the time for cats. And there's an agreement. I said, yeah, yeah. I kind of like said, ha. Huh. But that's how it is. So animals aren't the answer. Animals are not the answer. This is very important. Part of dharmic culture, you must realize that animals are not the answer. And people are having a terrible struggle with that. They're just like free-falling into animal worship, creature worship is really it is, because they see themselves as creatures. That's why they're creature worshiping. They think, oh yeah, I'm just that's my brother dog there, brother creature there. No, we're not creatures. So creatures just totally turn me off. And I see these surf videos have these, young women in bikinis walking on the beach. And it's revolting, actually. It's very revolting. They're just into creatureness. And that's revolting. So, and the music is revolting, too, that they have. It's creature music. But the vibe of surfing these sparkling waves is kind of cool. But they just can't seem to make, good videos. Some of them are pretty cool, but they themselves are on the creature level sort of thing. They're not dharmic. I watched Kelly Slater videos. It's pretty cool. I mean, Kelly Slater's pretty cool. Pretty cool dude. He's a very cool dude. Greatest surfer of all time. I was wondering what makes him so good, because I really haven't paid attention to surfing for the last 40 odd years or more. And so I missed him. I missed him. But he's a great, they say he's the greatest surfer of all time. I was watching him surf, some of his greatest waves and stuff. And I saw some stuff. I just said, wow. Yeah, he always does something. You say, wow. on the wave. It's like, yeah, you see him doing all this stuff, so other people do that, but he has this extra gear on the waves where he'll do something. This surf narrator was narrating a wave at Chapu in Tahiti at the final heat with John Florence. It was their finals, those two. And this guy's like I think the commentator was like a world champion surfer at some point. You know, he's a great surfer on his own right. And he says, O'Kelly just does this. And they're replaying the wave. And he says, okay, he drops. There's the drop in. He does an unbelievable drop where he basically virtually lost it. And he somehow he makes the drop. And then he just cars this bottom turn. It's like unbelievable. What? And then he somehow pulls up back onto the barrel. He said, what? And what did he do? And so the commentator says, I don't even know what he did on that wave because I've never done that. And he says, Kelly will do something on just one wave that it takes us a lifetime of surfing to do. I mean, he'll do it just all in one wave. So the guys are like in awe of him, kind of. He figures it out on the fly so fast that he'll throw a little something in there, a little wrinkle in there, and just kind of like, oh, what? Real smooth, real quick, little wrinkle, where you know others are just, they don't quite see that, don't quite get to it. So he's really, really, really great surfer. There's no doubt about it. There are a lot of other ones, but he has a little something extra. How he caught his balance, how he catches his balance. I saw something, I just said, oh, are you kidding me? Holy cow. He's double jointed, actually, which helps explain it. That he was able to keep his balance and his body's, you know, his board and his body and everything, and then still stay in the pocket and then just wow. We're fortunate if we ever do that. You know, that's what he's saying. Like, wow, I'm fortunate if I ever had a wave like that, if I ever caught my balance and did that, even in my whole surfing life, I would feel like, wow, I've really done something really tremendous surfing. But that's just one maneuver on a wave that he does. He throws all these other maneuvers in too. It's like, you know, like, oh, I just caught my balance in the most insane way possible on this insane wave, but now I'm like just doing a bunch of other stuff too. And then, you know, but as he finished the wave, he's kind of like, oh, wow, that was pretty cool. And he finishes the wave with flair, too. And the way he finishes it, you know, he celebrates it. So that's fun. Watching Kelly Slater surf is fun. And he surfs, still surfing. I think this is, I don't know how old he is. It might be 44 now, actually. Interesting name. For age. I walked into the store today. I said, wow, this store's been here a long time. How long has it been here? And he said, I think he said like 40, what did he say? 40 years or 44 years. This is just like, what? So Slater's like maybe 44, and yet he's going to go for another championship run, going for number 12. Pretty symbolic. Number 12 this year. He has 11. And he may get it. I mean, he's still good enough to win the world championship because he's so great in competition and he knows how to do it. John Florence may be the best all around. I mean, he's the hot surfer right now, the young surfer. He's really, really, really good. But Slater could win the, Gabriel Medina is also really great. So I think as a comment, Jordy Smith, you know, those four guys probably, you know, or could, you know, battle it out for the championship. And there's a few other guys in there, but those are the top guys right now. Medina's from Brazil. Florence from Hawaii. Slater from USA. And Jordy Smith from South Africa. Different styles and stuff. But Slater can just absolutely tear it up in any conditions. He's got that little extra something. Interesting. How having that little extra something, it comes through somehow. You know, it comes through. You realize, oh, this, we're watching something here that's just really wowish, really wow, wowish. So I look forward to watching, there's a summer thing, watching the Surf Tour, Slater and John Florence going at it. The old man, the 44-year-old, and the 20, young 20-something, right? That should be, that's something to look forward to in the year, I guess, right? But we need something more than that, actually. We need something more than that. We need some Dharma King participation. Some Dharma King Dharma. We need some Dharma King Dharma, actually, to let us know that they know it's still summer inside for us. They know. To let us know that they know, they can see it, they know. So I know inside it's the endless summer for you still. And you're totally certain. Okay, I know that. You are in this, you may be very uncertain about right now, but I'm not uncertain at all. I know it for 100% pure fact. So we need some Dharma King Dharma. And what is Dharma? Well, Dharma is what frees us from karma, right? Dharma is what frees us from karma. And karma is the belief that this imaginary mind has some sort of effect upon our true mind, which it doesn't. It's all pretense. It has no effect. But karma is the misbelief, is the misbelief, false belief. Karma is false belief. And so Dharma evaporates karma. Truth evaporates falsity. All right? Grace of God evaporates illusion. It evaporates our familiarity problem. Okay, it does. So Dharma evaporates karma. Dharma evaporates karma. Very great. And now I'm going to head for the hills where it's summer. It's summer inside the house right now. So I'm headed for the endless summer right now. All right, endless summertime. I'll sing the song of endless summer certainty.